Thank you, Hisham.
No problem.
So what the prompt said that I would discuss, and I'm certainly happy to discuss this still in the course of a conversation that we have with one another, is that this would be a survey of what happened during Operation Protective Edge, the 51-day Israeli aerial and ground assault against the Gaza Strip in the summer of 2014, that then shifted to a discussion of a survey of the violations and possible remedies under international humanitarian law specifically, without really getting into criminal law, but that have many implications in criminal law, obviously, as violations of the laws of war do, and then end with a discussion of the prospect of ICC jurisdiction and prosecution. Given that this is not completely a legal audience, while that's a very interesting discussion, I'm happy to, you know, obviously it'll come up in the conversation, I've decided instead of focusing on the law to do something similar yet different. So I'll still set the framework for the lead up to the 2014 war. But instead of discussing the law specifically, I want to shift to place the Gaza Strip in legal and political context. The legal context actually builds on a report that was something that I had been thinking about and researching, but has been affirmed by a report that was released this morning by Breaking the Silence, an Israeli NGO comprised of former Israeli soldiers. The report this morning is a testimony by 60 soldiers who participated in the war last summer, who gave us an insight into the rules of engagement under which they engaged in combat in the Gaza Strip. And that testimony helps illuminate, right, helps us comment on whether, in fact, Israel was the most moral army in the world, as it insisted it was. More importantly, it helps to explain why the, y'all want to sit, please welcome. There's seats open. So it helps to explain the high number of casualties. So there is something to be said about the law, and I will discuss how Israel's own engagement with the laws of war made it possible to kill as many civilians and to destroy as much civilian infrastructure as it did, all within what Israel insisted was within the bounds of law. So their insistence wasn't rhetorical, it was in fact rooted in a legal analysis, and one in which I take issue with, and maybe other scholars would beg to differ, and I'm certainly open to that conversation. So that's that legal context helps explain the high humanitarian register of death and destruction, because that, in fact, was unprecedented, though the campaign against the Gaza Strip clearly wasn't. The second part I want to explain is to put this in some political context, because since 1993, at least, Israel has been keen on separating the Gaza Strip from the rest of the Palestinian-Israel conflict, to set it apart and to distinguish it from what's happening, for example, in East Jerusalem vis-a-vis refugees in the West Bank, to say that the Gaza Strip is, for all intents and purposes, different because of the presence of what I would describe as a political party with an irregular combat force, and Israel would describe as a terrorist organization, Hamas. And so why then does Israel set the Gaza Strip apart, and how in fact is it part and parcel and continuous of the conflict? So to then set it in a political framework and political context to explain that the warfare, this counterinsurgency campaign, is in fact a continuation of Israel's policies vis-a-vis all Palestinians, irrespective of geographic residence or legal jurisdiction. And yet, obviously, in a much more grotesque form, what explains the different tactics in the Gaza Strip when Israel would be in a much better place politically, economically, even in terms of just its PR, were it to deal with the Gaza Strip like it deals with the West Bank? And so what explains that difference? So I'll do each of those in three parts. And for the sake of, for any of you, anybody who came to the earlier lecture, and you know that I have a tendency to follow my thoughts like a butterfly, I'm going to read this because it's a lot of content. So, in the lead up to the 51-day assault on the Gaza Strip, we witnessed a number of incidents that ratcheted up the stakes. This began with the kidnapping and murder of three Israeli settler boys, two boys anyway, and a young adult near Hebron. Although Israeli police had confirmation that they were killed on the first day of their disappearance, Israel set out to find them in the West Bank in a sweeping campaign that killed nine Palestinians, to arrest nearly 800 others who had been released previously in the Gilad Shalit prisoner exchange, and the raid of 1,300 Palestinian residential and commercial sites in an operation known as Brother's Keeper. In this context, Israeli settlers kidnapped a Palestinian boy and burned him alive in a Jerusalem forest. And this is just to give you some background of what was leading up to where we ended up in the summer. It's just important to note that about the kidnapping of the Palestinian boy, the significant difference in the way that we responded to his kidnapping than the kidnapping of the Jewish settler's boy. On the first, in the first instance, just the most obvious of how much attention it got. But the second instance is the fact that Palestinians are completely reliant on Israel for their own protection. And so they were reliant on the Israeli police to search for the boy. So it just gives you an idea of the context that we oftentimes discuss this as a conflict between two parties, even two state parties, when there is no sense of parity between these two parties. And so that that reminds us and underscores the power disparity and the structural differences between these Palestinians, who are stateless, in most instances, or are second-class citizens or refugees, who have a quasi-government, versus the 11th most powerful army in the world with the unequivocal support of world superpower, which we are all the beneficiaries of, right? We're all the beneficiaries of this, of our empire. But all of this is a backdrop of the worst yet to come. For those paying close attention, it was clear that Prime Minister Bibi Netanyahu has since won an election again, was using this opportunity to confront Hamas and to bring them into the foray. Despite the fact that the top echelons of Hamas repeatedly rejected responsibility for the kidnapping of the Israeli settler boys, and the fact that all of those incidents took place within the West Bank, it seemed irrelevant. This factual background seemed irrelevant, and no one seemed to notice that Netanyahu was provoking a confrontation with Hamas in order to deflect a number of domestic considerations, including at least four things: Netanyahu's failure to prevent the Palestinian unity government between Fatah and Hamas, his failure to prevent the ascendancy of President Reuven Rivlin, the failure to disrupt U.S.-Iranian rapprochement, which we saw the last great stand against that in his controversial address to Congress. And finally, the fact that when the peace process collapsed yet again in April 2014, Secretary of State John Kerry laid blame for the collapse of the peace process on Netanyahu. So while it's clear that Netanyahu wanted to drag Hamas into a direct military confrontation, I don't think that he wanted it to be as aggressive nor as long-lasting as it was. But as a result of it, this summer we witnessed unprecedented levels of violence, just in magnitude, not in form, upon a besieged population. The Gaza Strip is only 365 square kilometers large and home to 1.8 million Palestinians, 1.2 million of whom are refugees from literally a few kilometers to the north and to the east. Its dense constitution makes any attack on the Gaza Strip an attack on the entire population. With nowhere to hide and prevent it from fleeing elsewhere, the Palestinian population was arbitrarily subject to a killing campaign for 51 days. Consider also Israel's own military code of conduct, which turns traditional humanitarian law on its head and makes at least four troubling claims. And this is what I mentioned, that the report issued by Break the Silence this morning actually affirms these findings. One, humanitarian law, the laws of armed conflict or the laws of war, depends actually how you describe them depends on your own political orientation. I'll call it humanitarian law because I do believe that its purpose is to prevent civilians during warfare, which may be inevitable, but that the military advantage should be mitigated in order to protect civilians from harm. So amongst the primary tenets in humanitarian law is the principle of distinction, which obligates a belligerent adversary to distinguish between civilians and combatants. And there's even a more graduated analysis than that, or I guess a gradient analysis, which is to distinguish between combatants, those who are taking up in arms, non-combatants, those who are part of a military force but are not taking up in arms but do other activities in warfare like cook, drive the ambulance, maybe provide some sort of medical support. And then the third category of direct participation in hostilities in a an irregular combat like the one between Israel and Hamas, those would be the civilians who take up arms for a limited amount of time and then place it down, and then civilians who retain immunity. Why this distinction? Because the idea is that combatants have the right to kill. They're expected to kill, and it's not considered murder. There's no criminal liability. It's killing and not murder. They also are legitimate targets during warfare, so that you can kill a combatant and it's not murder. Non-combatants, in most instances, should be spared from harm. Direct participants in hostilities can be legitimate targets insofar as they're carrying arms. And then civilians should be granted immunity during all times. You can kill civilians as well if, and in those cases, you can't target them. There's an absolute prohibition on the targeting of civilians. But if you kill civilians, they're considered collateral damage during warfare, and you have to measure that harm against the military advantage that was achieved. Okay, how is that relevant here? During the course of this combat, Israel labeled all members of Hamas, irrespective of whether they were combatants or non-combatants, as legitimate targets, so that law enforcement officers were indistinguishable from the Hamas combatants that actually were carrying rocket propeller grenades. Okay? They also didn't distinguish from those direct participants in hostilities who were no longer carrying arms but may have been sleeping alongside their families and wives and children, not multiple wives, but wife and children in a single household. In a single household, and didn't distinguish them from the civilians in many instances as well. And so that collapse of who is a civilian significantly truncated who was entitled to civilian immunity, which made many of them legitimate targets within the language of humanitarian law. Right? So it was no coincidence that 2,200 people were killed. Israel didn't contest that, but, for example, insisted that those civilians who were warned of an impending attack, either by the dropping of leaflets or by a text message or by phone calls or with a mini rocket, what's known as the knock-on-the-roof approach, a small rocket before a larger rocket falls, a missile falls on the house, that if those civilians didn't flee after receiving the warning, that they had foregone their civilian immunity and had become human shields. This is absolutely not true in the language of the law. There's other things to consider, including the adequacy of the warning. Was the warning, in fact, adequate? In most of these cases, as has been documented by El Mizan and other human rights organizations within the Gaza Strip, they were inadequate because they were often given conflicting reports on where to flee to. And in fact, in 7 instances where Palestinians fled to UNRWA, or United Nations Refugee Works Agency schools, that were sites of that were meant to be shelters and designated as shelters. In 7 instances, Israel targeted the shelters themselves. In what now has been discussed and investigated by the UN Board of Inquiry on the issue, the results have found that Israel was in fact responsible for those attacks. Israel's own military advocate general has said, we're investigating whether or not it was a mistake. But of course, they'll say it was an accident. But all that to say that by failing to make these distinctions and by considering so many civilians actually legitimate targets, this is part of the reason there was such a high death toll. The second is in regard to civilian infrastructure. So again, under humanitarian law, civilian infrastructure should be immune from combat. If instead infrastructure is used to either launch attacks, to hide weapons as a training center, that then is military in nature. It becomes military infrastructure and is a legitimate target. So to distinguish, to actually go through the analysis, you must first determine whether or not something is civilian in nature. Then to assess whether or not the targeting of it would accrue a military advantage to the belligerent. And third, whether or not that military advantage outweighs this harm that will be caused to civilians. In the course of combat, Israel did not conduct this analysis. Instead, it was sufficient to say that the place of infrastructure, insofar it had anything to do with Hamas, which is the governing body in the Gaza Strip since 2006, which means all government municipalities, all government schools, all government hospitals, all buildings that were built by Hamas or resided in by Hamas members become military targets as a matter of fact without this assessment, which is also what made it possible to inflict such great harm on civilian infrastructure, but within the language of law. Thirdly, there is an analysis of proportionality. Proportionality is a twin pillar of humanitarian law, like distinction, but it says that the military advantage achieved should outweigh the harm. So it's not, if Hamas shoots 5 rockets, we get to fire 5 missiles back. It basically says we can destroy this much if the military advantage in doing so, it outweighs the harm that we'll be creating. Usually that assessment, there's 2 ways to conduct the assessment, either in ongoing hostilities or in the framework of the law of self-defense. I won't bore you with the detail, but this is the point here, is that in an ongoing conflict, the idea is that the military advantage is what will it take to win the war. But Israel didn't conduct its analysis of what it would take to its military advantage, of what it would necessary to win the war. It conducted its proportionality assessment based on what I've been saying has been a 10-year forward-looking analysis, that what it would take to prevent Hamas or any other irregular force from engaging in combat against Israel for the future 10 years. I was wrong. According to the Israeli soldiers who released their testimony today, it was a 5-year forward-looking analysis, which is nonetheless quite detrimental if you think about the protection that civilians should be afforded. To think, how much harm should I cause or is legitimate to cause in order to prevent Hamas from engaging in combat for the next 5 years is significantly more harm than one could contemplate in an exact battle to actually win that battle and that exact war. So, under these circumstances, under this reading of humanitarian law, together with the fact of Hamas's density and the fact that the borders are sealed. There are 5 points of ingress and egress from the Gaza Strip, 4 are controlled by Israel, 1 is controlled by Egypt. All 5 were sealed during the operation. There seemed to be no shelters that were actually immune from attack, as the UN Board of Inquiry report demonstrated. So there was nowhere to go. It's a highly densely populated area. There's nowhere to flee. And Israel, in the first, so the campaign against the Gaza Strip begins on July 1st or 3rd. So let me just put it out there because I haven't first referred. July 17th, it begins its aerial strikes once it discovers Hamas's tunnel network that enables its militants to actually infiltrate Israeli territory, which it created in order to capture soldiers. Okay, perfectly legal under humanitarian law. It's actually encouraged the capturing of soldiers in order to exchange them in for other prisoners of war. Of course, the way that we frame this is that Israeli soldiers, even our president, described this as barbaric and said that it was the kidnapping of Israeli soldiers. But of course, kidnapping is limited to how we describe the absconding of civilians, not of soldiers, right? And so there's also a lot to be said for the rhetoric of how we frame this. In any case, between the beginning of the aerial attacks and July 17th, when the ground combat begins, Israel also expands the buffer zone by 40%. So the Gaza Strip, which is already highly densely populated with 1.8 million people, 1.2 million who are refugees, they become more densely populated in an even smaller area. Under these conditions, together with this reading of humanitarian law, which is very, I think, turns it on its head, the results can only be devastating. There was no, what we saw was inevitable, given the way that the cards were stacked in this context, as indeed they were. 2,152 Palestinians were killed, 504 children were killed, 143 families lost three or more people, 1,500 Palestinians became orphans, 140,000 homes were partially, severely, or completely destroyed, 9,000 were completely destroyed. By the way, not a single home has been rebuilt despite the pledging of $5.4 billion by the international community, and I'm happy to discuss the politics of the impediment of the transfer of that aid. At the height of the onslaught, one-third of the population became internally displaced. 22 schools were destroyed. 118 were damaged. 373,000 children are in need of psychosocial treatment. Israeli forces also attacked basic civilian infrastructure necessary for survival, including Gaza's sole power plant and the largest sewage treatment plant, causing 15,000 tons of solid waste to leak into Gaza's streets. It destroyed 419 businesses, 36 fishing boats, and 42,000 acres of agricultural farmland. It exacerbated the unemployment rate, which was 45% before the start of this most recent offensive, and it has become 70% unemployment amongst youth aged 20 to 24. Israel targeted Palestinian civilians as well. It targeted, as I mentioned, the seven UNRWA schools and one incident in the north of the Gaza Strip in an UNRWA school in Jabalia. UNRWA provided Israel with its GPS coordinates no less than 17 times. It had been giving shelter to 3,000 civilians at the time. Israel, nonetheless, without warning in this instance, according to the Board of Inquiry investigation, launched a rocket that caused shrapnel to fire into the school at 4:30 in the morning. 15 minutes later, Israel then launched four 115-millimeter mortar rockets. In total, 17 Palestinians were killed in this instance, including four children. In Shija'iya, it killed 66 people in 60 minutes in a revenge killing spree labeled the Hannibal Doctrine. The Hannibal Doctrine is a doctrine that has become apparent to us during this offensive, wherein Israel sets out to wreak havoc in the case of a soldier being captured. So it becomes a deterrent to capture the soldier, especially to the civilians in the area who will bear the brunt. So when Israel says that Palestinians were used as human shields, for as much as Hamas capturing a soldier, they then became human shields because they became the target of these revenge killings. And the idea was that Israel did not want its soldiers to be captured in order to not have another episode of a Gilad Shalit, which severely diminished the morale of Israeli society as well as diminished the popularity of Israeli politicians at the time. So it became more advantageous for Israel to actually kill its soldier rather than have him be captured, and then a negotiating chip for prisoners of war. In Shija'iyya, they killed, as I mentioned, 66 people. In Rafah, in a similar campaign, they killed 150. And Khaza'a, what we understand is that civilians were killed as they were fleeing, as indicated by bullets in their back. And one of the most chilling episodes that we bore witness to this summer was in mid-July, when two Israeli missiles launched consecutively and coldly killed Ismail, Zakaria, Ahed, and Mohammed Bakr, aged 9 through 11, who played soccer on Gaza shores. And this, of course, we all might remember because it happened right in front of the hotel on the Gazan shore where there were journalists had been staying. The worst part about these casualties is it wasn't the first time Palestinians in Gaza would endure this horror, and worse perhaps is that it will not be the last time. This could not be the last time. This is actually now part and parcel of Israel's military approach to the Gaza Strip, and I'll explain why. First of all, the ceasefire that was established on August 26th is vague. It lacks any implementation mechanisms. It's almost identical to the ceasefire negotiated by Egypt in November 2012 in the aftermath of Operation Pillar of Defense. And unfortunately, this confrontation did little to alter the status quo between Israel, between Hamas and Gaza, or Palestinians, sorry, Hamas and Israel, or between Palestinians writ large and Israel. And yet, unless a political agreement is achieved, it has to be repeated because we have reached a stalemate. For Palestinians, this is not to say it was for naught. For Palestinians, it was actually a show of resistance, not to afford, you know, to attribute any, you know, congratulatory, you know, accolades to Hamas. To the contrary, that's not my point at all. The resistance was demonstrated by Palestinians who were able to transcend the violent bifurcations that divide them between the Gaza Strip, the West Bank, Israel, East Jerusalem, and in the diaspora, who all showed support for a quick moment against this assault. For Israelis, the recurring campaign has become necessary. Rather than reflect its power, this brute force evidences the weakness of Israel's hegemonic project. In contrast to the success of settler colonialism here in the United States, and even perhaps in Canada and in Australia, and this, you know, one can attribute the success, you know, the relative success, although indigenous populations here are very much still resisting their removal, their dispossession, and their displacement. The population, the number of Palestinians that have remained on the land, makes it less likely for Israel to achieve the same kind of hegemony whereby the native population can be concentrated and placed under a framework where they're giving limited autonomy, though not for the lack of trying, obviously. So where does that put Israel? They clearly can't pummel Palestinians into submission, though they've tried. They don't want a two-state solution or peace with Palestinians, though, and for anybody, by the way, that was wondering whether or not Israel was genuine about its desire for a two-state solution, Prime Minister Netanyahu made that unequivocally clear, that there will not be a Palestinian state. So you can't pummel Palestinians into submission. There will not be political solution whereby Palestinians are given sovereignty in their own state. And although Israel, during this assault, indicated its Knesset member Yuval Steinitz repeatedly, if you had caught him on BBC several times, had indicated that Israel was interested in putting boots back on the ground in the Gaza Strip. In 2005, Israel unilaterally removed its settlers and its settler infrastructure, including the military infrastructure that protected it, though that didn't change the status of the Gaza Strip as occupied territory, and I'm happy to talk about why not. But the point is that they removed those boots on the ground. In this offensive, Israel indicated it wanted to put boots back on the ground, but they could not. And the reason that they could not is because, despite all obstacles, Hamas, between 2006 and the present, in 2014, has actually been able to build a paramilitary force that has shown some ability to engage in combat. And that was indicated, even if you think about the casualties. Hamas killed 72 Israelis. 66 of them were soldiers. Those soldiers were killed during ground combat within the Gaza Strip, indicating that Hamas had mastered that ground combat on its own turf. So it becomes almost impossible for Israel to put its boots back on the ground because they would be at a military disadvantage. I think, just to mention, 8% of Hamas casualties were civilians, in contrast to 70% of Israel's casualties who were civilians, notwithstanding the fact that all of Hamas rocket fire is crude weaponry that is ipso facto illegal because it can't distinguish between civilians and combatants. So that principle of distinction I mentioned, Hamas can't even comply with it if it shoots its rockets because it has crude weaponry. But notwithstanding that crude weaponry, Israel actually caused much more harm proportionally, and it has precise weaponry and sophisticated technology. So in light of these foreclosed possibilities, Israel has aggressively pursued a military counterinsurgency in Gaza marked by remote control and low-intensity combat most of the time, and intermittent and regular military campaigns aimed at quote-unquote mowing the lawn. This is part of a lexicon that emerges in asymmetric warfare that acknowledges that a regular combat force can't defeat its irregular adversary, and so the objective is just to diminish the capacity to engage in hostilities, mowing the lawn, attacking their weapons caches, making it more difficult for them to launch attacks, and so on and so forth. I think it's quite perverse. And it's a grotesque euphemism that actually targets civilians and civilian infrastructure, also to diminish the civilians' population's support for the governing body, which is why several commentators on behalf of Israel insisted that in this Operation Protective Edge, they were doing a favor for Palestinians so that they can rid themselves of Hamas. Okay. Notwithstanding all of this, Israel's campaign against the Gaza Strip is not Gaza-specific, it's actually Palestine-specific. Let me briefly say, and this is the extension of this, that Israel's policy towards Palestinians is driven by two axioms. One is the acquisition of the greatest amount of land with the least number of Palestinians, and the concentration of the greatest number of Palestinians on the least amount of land. So a ghettoization policy and the annexation of land. Israel has successfully done this in the West Bank since 1967. Here we have a map. Sadly, we don't see a lot of maps, so I wanted to just include this. Israel, the West Bank, the Gaza Strip. These disconnected areas are to be the Palestinian state, which I think Israel has completely destroyed. These borders that you see are meaningless. This is an imaginary partition, even within Israeli society, who have unimpeded access from Tel Aviv to as far as the Jordan Valley, right? So from Tel Aviv to the Jordan Valley, there is no impediment to travel for Israelis or for settlers. So it's an imaginary partition in society, but also because these borders are meaningless. Despite their consecration in UN Security Council's Resolution 242 and 338, Israel has never accepted these borders. The moment that the Obama administration actually mentioned the Palestinian state within these borders, it created a whole lot of controversy because of response from the Israel lobby. I don't want to go through a detailed analysis of this. I'm going to just show you images to demonstrate the twin axioms. In the West Bank, this is what's happened as a result. The areas here are where Palestinians are being concentrated. The rest of the gray area is Area C, 62% of the West Bank under the framework of the Oslo Accords, where Israel has not ceased its settlement enterprise for a single day. Its settler population has increased from 200,000 in 1993 to 600,000 today. And not only must you confiscate land to build the settlements, but you must build the bypass roads that are restricted for Israeli use only, as well as the military infrastructure to protect these bypass roads and the settlers and the settlements. It also results in the maldistribution of water. The most significant water source is located under the West Bank, the Western Aquifer. 60% of it is located there. Israel derives 80% of its yield. also in violation of law on the distribution of water, which is based on proximity and populations in proximity to it. Instead, it's disproportionately allocated for Israelis. So this is the West Bank. I think this one will be the most obvious for you, of this policy of removal and concentration. But this is Israel also. Within Israel itself, which we tend to remove and discuss the occupied territories as distinct from Israel, Israel is pursuing a very similar policy. This, which you see here, is the Negev, which is the desert here in southern Israel. I can give you an entire lecture on the Negev or the Naqab in Arabic. But here, there are approximately resident 90,000 Palestinian citizens of the state. Israel seeks to remove 70,000 of them from their agricultural livelihood. Most of them live in 35 unrecognized villages, which means they have no access to electricity, water, or any connection to the rest of the state, so they have no access to basic services. I can go on and on. I need to stop. Okay, but they want to remove 70,000 of those Palestinian citizens and forcibly place them in urban townships. In their place, the state will build settlements for Jewish citizens only. So the settlement enterprise that we disdain in the West Bank is also very vibrant within Israel itself, vis-a-vis its own Israeli citizens. And so that's what you see here, the concentration, and I can also talk about the Galilee, where there's the greatest concentration of Palestinian citizens of the state, but I want to get back to Gaza and just draw the continuity between these policies. Here's the expanded buffer zone. So although Israel is not removing and concentrating Palestinians in what looks like it's doing in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, it's very much concentrating Palestinians and confiscating more land using military tactics. And here we see the acquisition of that land in the course of this last operation, 40% of the Gaza Strip. That's where the majority of the homes and the 42,000 acres of farmland, that's where they were destroyed. So the question then becomes, why would Israel engage in this kind of combat with the Gaza Strip? It's horrible for its PR. It's far too expensive. In the West Bank, they have flipped the bill for the policing of Palestinians to the international community, and they've given the responsibility of policing Palestinians to the Palestinian Authority, whose police forces, 140,000 of whom are on the public payroll, have been trained by the U.S., and specifically U.S. General Keith Dayton. So if you're familiar with this arrangement, it's Palestinians who are policing Palestinians and protecting Israel's settlement enterprises in the West Bank. It seems like a much more politically savvy arrangement than to engage in these hostilities, which are costly and which Israeli society does not, despite the discourse over the war, like turn Gaza into a parking lot, like genocide in Gaza now, like kill the mothers so that they can't birth snakes. Israel actually is averse to this warfare because all of its soldiers are conscripted into the army, and so it's not a choice. And so that's why also in Breaking the Silence report, you'll find that the Israeli army creates parity between its soldiers and the Palestinian civilians. Why doesn't it do what it does in the West Bank? So briefly, let me tell you, Israel actually attempted to physically occupy Gaza and control it through the presence of settlers in the same way it does the West Bank, and it first started in 1956. 7 years before occupation and the Six-Day War as we know it, but at that time the occupation only lasted for 4 months because the U.S. opposed it, and so forced the withdrawal of Israeli soldiers. It returns in 1967, as we know, integrates the water system into Israel's water system, integrates the electricity grid into Israel's electricity grid by 1970. In 1969, Ariel Sharon is appointed the head of Israel's Southern Command and is given jurisdiction over the Gaza Strip to oversee a pacification campaign. That pacification was very challenging because the Gaza Strip was a site of immense guerrilla resistance. This is 1967. Nearly 20 years before the emergence of Hamas, or Palestinian Islamic Jihad. But it was still the site of guerrilla resistance, and it was also supported by then Egyptian President Jamal Abdel Nasser. Under a Sharon's pacification campaign, Israeli forces divide the Gaza Strip. Divides the Gaza Strip into squares and proceeds to systematically go square by square, house by house, to capture and interrogate militant subjects, suspects. And between July and December 1971, Israeli forces kill 742 Palestinian guerrilla fighters, and as a result of bulldozing 200 new miles of security roads through Gaza, similar to the bypass roads in the West Bank, they displaced 16,000 new refugees. Israel established its first settlement in Gaza, Kfar Duram, after their evacuation from the Sinai in 1970, and transforms its six outposts into permanent settlements. It even attempted to appoint an indigenous proxy leader in 1970, a Palestinian, to be the mayor of Gaza under Israeli rule. But the Palestinians resident in Gaza refused this altogether. In December 1981, Israel established direct control over Gaza's non-security sectors like health, education, welfare. And in response, Gaza's professional sectors of doctors, lawyers, engineers go on strike from 1981 until 1991 in order to protest Israel's attempts to control by direct military control in the way that they do the West Bank. But that has, as I mentioned, has not always been by Hamas. Hamas, despite, you know, how much we have been trained to believe that this is a war against Hamas, and Hamas is the root of the conflict, and this is about rocket fire, Hamas isn't established until 1973, when Sheikh Ahmed Yassin establishes the offshoot of the Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood. Between 1973 and 1988, he insists that it's an apolitical formation aimed at spiritually reviving Islam in the hearts of Palestinians, that is apolitical. As a result of competition from Palestinian Islamic Jihad, which also incorporates a nationalist platform, Hamas then adopts a nationalist platform in 1988. And it engages in its first military operation in 1989 when it captures and kills two Israeli soldiers. Now, what happens after that? Let's see. I'll help describe what's happening here. 1991 is a major turning point because it's the end of the Gulf War, and as a result, for Yasser Arafat, former PLO chairman, his support for Saddam Hussein, Kuwait evicts Palestinians who had been there. This has a lot to do with the status of Palestinian refugees. I'm also happy to talk about that in Q&A. But that eviction was very detrimental to the Palestinian economy. Those remittances constituted nearly 50% of Gaza's GNP. It also meant that Gaza no longer had an export market for its produce. In 1991, at the same time, Israel also begins to import foreign labor and prevent Palestinian labor from traveling from the occupied territories into Israel to conduct menial work that nobody wants to do. But the economic downturn is severe. The number of Palestinian families receiving food aid rose from 10,000 in 1990 to 120,000 by June 1991. As a result of this economic downturn, Gaza's GDP falls by 41%. By 1993, that stabilizes at 80,000 who are now in need of food aid for survival. At the end of this latest offensive, that number has jumped from 80,000 in 1993 who are dependent on food aid for survival to over 830,000 Palestinians who survive on food aid. So there's a deliberate policy of impoverishment that continues to take place. This is all happening in the midst of the Madrid Peace Conference, which is, of course, the precursor to the Oslo Accords. Israel is actually preparing for the landscape of the possibility of a Palestinian state. By March 1993, though we refer to 2007 as the imposition of the naval siege and land blockade, 1993 is the first imposition of the first complete closure of the Gaza Strip using fence, barbed wire, and military installation. 9 months later, the PLO and Israel signed the Oslo Accords on the White House lawn. 3 months after that, in December 1993, Shimon Peres explicitly states the intentions for the Gaza Strip, that it will become the future Palestinian state, and that the status of the West Bank will be determined at a later state, but that it has to account for the Israeli populations therein. So by 1993, Israel has made Gaza dependent, completely dependent on food aid, announced an intention to transform it into the Palestinian state, and has sealed it off. And at this point, there has not been a single rocket and not a single suicide attack. Hamas launches its first suicide attack on April 7th, 1994, 2 months after the Ibrahimi Mosque massacre, where Baruch Goldstein, an Israeli settler, enters a Hebron mosque and unleashes live fire on 29 Palestinian worshippers in the mosque at dawn prayer. Hamas launches the first suicide attack in April 1994. Sorry, not 29, 35 Palestinians praying at the time. In 1996, Netanyahu was elected into office for the first time, and that was when he made clear his opposition to the peace process. He didn't say there would be no state, but he said that I do not support the peace process. And fast forward to the failure of the Camp David Accords and what's known, perhaps incorrectly, as the Second Palestinian Intifada, which is much more militarized than the First Palestinian Intifada in 1987. And the second one that begins after the collapse of the Camp David Accords, it's actually Palestinian militants who are engaging in combat rather than civil society predominantly. And in response to that, Israel announces its intention to build the wall and cracks down on Palestinian activism altogether. Also announces in April 2004 that we will disengage from Gaza altogether. Okay? So between the time of the announcement of Ariel Sharon exchanging letters with George W. Bush at the time intending a unilateral disengagement from Gaza and the actual disengagement in August-September 2005, Ariel Sharon oversaw the 8 military campaigns to expand the northern and southern buffer zones in the Gaza Strip, as well as to assassinate Hamas's military leaders, including Abdel Aziz al-Rantisi. But those campaigns never stopped. We talk about 3 campaigns against the Gaza Strip: Cast Lead, Pillar of Cloud, and Protective Edge in the last 6.5 years. But in fact, since 2004, there have been 22 military campaigns, 14 since unilateral disengagement. So fast forward, Hamas's electoral victory in 2006, the ousting of Fatah, Cast-Lead, Protective Pillar of Cloud, and now the summer of 2014, where does that place us? It places us perhaps in one of the worst places that we've been in. The fact that Israel now explicitly opposes a political solution puts us in a condition where it seeks to continue to control Gaza by remote control and by domination. But consider also that within the Gaza Strip, the World Health Organization has said that it will become unlivable by 2020, which is in about 4.5 years. So as far as Gazans are concerned, they're going to die quietly while nobody's watching, or they may die while everybody's watching. So you create this untenable situation where Israel has backed itself into a corner politically because it's foreclosed political possibilities, but it's also placed Palestinians in a position where there's no way out. They're either going to die as a result of this humanitarian devastation, as a result of the siege and the economic dependence, or they're going to die in an outright campaign that actually has some international attention. So for those reasons, I am convinced that this is, the next attack is inevitable. The next confrontation is inevitable. There are murmurings right now that Hamas and Israel are engaged in direct actual negotiations. Secret negotiations, not clear if they're actually mediated by Egypt this time, but they some sort of an exchange of terms in order to not reach that position Not sure what exactly is going to happen as a result of that, though just to be clear, I don't think Hamas would have any problem with being given governance over the Gaza Strip as a separate entity from the rest of Palestine, from the rest of the Palestinian conflict. For them, I think their political calculations changed during the course of the Egyptian uprising, the ascendance of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, and set itself on a different political trajectory of possibilities within the Middle East. And so all that to say that we could see different outcomes, but certainly nothing that addresses the root of the Palestinian-Israel conflict. In the best case scenario and in the worst case scenario, we're likely going to see a similar campaign happen again. The only way to prevent it, obviously, is a political solution. A political solution requires political pressure. The incapacitation of that political pressure is here. The U.S. has prevented any type of actual redress and has done that using its status as superpower as well as its veto power within the U.N. Security Council, though it's indicated after Netanyahu's announcement in opposition to two states that it would lift its veto over any kind of resolution. But we've now heard that it won't lift it until it secures its deal with Iran. Because what it came into agreement is a framework agreement with Iran over nuclear proliferation. So they're not going to lift its protection of Israel right now, though they believe in a two-state solution until that's resolved. So that puts us more or less right back where we started. And the status quo is more or less the same except for Palestinians who are much, much, much worse off. So I'll end there. I'm sorry for it to be dismal, but I've talked for so long, so I'll leave it to Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Noura.